Good morning. It's time to begin our worship service here this morning at Maysville. It's good to see each and every one of you here. Hopefully you had a great week and we'll have a good week this week. It's also good to see a couple of visitors in the audience this morning, and we are delighted to see you, and we're honored to have you in our presence. If you are visiting with us, we ask that you please sign one of the visitor cards in the pew back in front of you, fill that out, and pass it toward the inner aisle, and as our ushers will come around in a couple of minutes and pick those up. I'll ask you to bear with me. There are tons of announcements this morning, so just stick with me here for a little bit and we'll try and get through them. I encourage you to pick up one of the bulletins this morning if you haven't already. If you look at our prayer list and those who have been sick and having surgeries, there's a long list here, and we've got some additions to those as well too. So I want to quickly run through those. A couple that we need to add on the prayer list. Basil Boggs is scheduled to have surgery on Tuesday for an aneurysm and blockage in his leg. He was scheduled to have it this past week, and because of his blood pressure being too high, they were unable to do it. So is scheduled to be at Huntsville Hospital, and that will be on Tuesday, so remember them. Trying to look around the room this morning and see others who have had surgery. Kenneth Morris had gallbladder surgery, so we need to remember him in our prayers this week as well, too. It's good to see Thomas back with us this morning, and as I was joking with him, he's got the best eyes in congregation this morning. So if you need him to check out something, go do that with him. It's also good to see Lois and Dot here with us this morning. Lois spent a couple days in the hospital last week. They did determine that it was a blood clot that kind of worked its way out, so that's good news. It's good to see them. He has written a note for the congregation. I'll read at this time. It says, "Dear brethren, thank you for your prayers, cards, and visits, and my recent health problems. Love, Lois Webster." So it's good to see both of them. Gordon Hicks is continuing to recover from surgery that he had. He is home and just still sore, so continue to remember him. Also, an update on Lon Pittman. He was not able to make it this morning from his treatments for prostate cancer. There was no cancer in the organs, which is great news, and they are waiting for the bone reports that will come back on Thursday. So continue to remember that family in your prayers this morning. Also, if you take a look down front this morning, Tom and Sandra are not with us again this morning. She is scheduled to have a spinal tap tomorrow morning. So let's continue to remember them at this point. The monthly fellowship, hopefully you're planning on sticking around tonight after services. The theme will be hamburgers and hot dogs, and we'll be celebrating birthdays and anniversaries for the last couple of months here, as it will be our last monthly fellowship for the year. As I mentioned, hot dogs and hamburgers will be served, and everybody's asked to bring fixings, so if you'll bring those with you tonight, and service team 3 is responsible. I'll remind you to continue to look down at the community outreach. That will be here before you know it. It'll be Saturday, December the 12th, as the items are continue to be listed in the bulletin. If you can help bring some of those in, that will be appreciated. The Ladies Helping Hands, they'll meet Thursday at 10 a.m. here in the building and collecting school supplies for the Inner City Church of Christ. If you want to help donate to some of those, feel free to do that. There will be a brief meeting for all planning on going to Honduras up front this morning, so right after services, if you'll meet right down front here to talk about your Honduras. There will be a jail ministry meeting and asking for all participants and the jail card ministry to please meet down front after services this morning, and they're going to cover a couple of points that they need to cover. So if you are helping in that, please come down front. A couple other announcements that we have here. The Woodville High School basketball team is selling various items from Dreamland Barbecue, and if you're interested in picking up some of those, you can see Thatcher Taylor. The Madison County High School softball team is hosting their craft show this Saturday from 9 until 3. And that will be in the auxiliary gym, the new gym up there at Madison County. Also, they're selling chicken dinner plates for $10 each, and you can pick those up from 11 to 1 a Saturday as well, too. Also, Lads the Leader sign up. You can continue to do that. If you have any questions, you can see Carrie with questions. We want to thank everybody, and as Seth told me this morning, except me, so I'm on the bad list this morning, who donated candy, money, and time to make this year's Fall Festival a success. Special thank you to the Edisons and Wilburns for taking care of the hayride. So again, we appreciate everybody helping with that yesterday afternoon. One other note, I'll make sure that you see in the bulletin. The time change, daylight savings time, will happen next Saturday night, so you'll get an extra hour of sleep, which means you can come an extra hour early for Bible study if you haven't been lately. So hope to see everybody here at 9, but don't forget to change those clocks. This morning, the opening song will be 153. Steve Harless will have our closing prayer. But to open up service this morning, Tim Fairchild will lead us in an opening prayer.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning thanking you for this day, thanking you for all the gifts and talents that you give us. We thank you for our church and our fellowship here. We thank you for our friends. We pray for those that are on the sick list this morning. The list is long, and we know that we have people that are going through trials, difficulties, illnesses. We pray that you'll bless them and show us the way that we can reach out to them and uplift them, provide some service to them, let them know that we care for them and that we are praying for them. We pray that you'll bless this service. As we go through this service, that we'll be attentive, that we'll worship you in a way that is pleasing to you, and that the service and the message will be something that we can take to heart, that we can take out into the world and show the world what Christians we are. We pray that you'll bless our leaders here, our deacons, our elders, those that guide this church, that provide services and works to the church. We pray that you bless them. We pray for our country, that you'll bless the leaders with wisdom and knowledge. We pray that you'll bless them with an understanding of your word and how our country could be better if we follow your word. We pray now that you'll go with us through this service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Number 153, we'll do the first, third, and the fourth stanzas, please.
Sweet little Lord, have we heard thee? We will.
247. Do all three stanzas of this one, please.
Here we are, but straying pilgrims here. Our path is often dim, but to cheer us on our journey, still we sing this wayside hymn. Yonder over the rolling river, where the shining mansions rise, soon will be our home forever, and the smile of the blessed giver gladdens all our longing eyes. Here our feet are often weary on the hills that throng our way. Here the tempest darkly gathers, but our hearts within us say, yonder over the rolling river, where the shining mansions rise, soon will be our home forever, and the smile of the blessed giver gladdens all our longing eyes. Here our souls are often fearful of the pilgrim lurking foe, but the Lord is our defender, and he tells us we may know. Yonder over the rolling river, where shining mansions rise, soon will be our home forever, and the smile of the blessed giver gladdens all our longing eyes.
435. We'll do the first stanza only. We pause in our moment of worship this morning to take our center thoughts back to the cross. We think about Jesus. We think about his life, his perfect life, we might say, as well. He did not commit sin, but yet he went to the cross, which was there he took away sin because he gave himself as sin in our place. And in doing so, we cherish that moment. We look back every Sunday because of that, not just once a year, 6 months or something like that, but every Sunday, as New Testament pattern is, to help refresh our thoughts about what he did for us there and draw us closer to him with more love to him.
More love to thee, O Christ, more love to
let's pray. Dear Father, bless us this morning with a vivid recollection of the things we know about the suffering of our Savior prior to his death on the cross. Help us, Father, to reflect upon the things that he suffered for us, that his body endured. As we think about the magnitude of his sacrifice, and what he's done for us, help us now partake of this loaf in a manner that's fitting in our sight. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we continue our thanks for the great sacrifice that was made on our behalf. And remember the blood that was shed by our Savior, the innocent blood was shed. We take of this cup and remember that blood. And we pray that each one here will reflect back on their own lives and take of it in a well-deserving manner. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Number 400, sing the first stanza only in just a moment. We come together this morning thinking about our opportunity to give back to God's kingdom. In our Bible study this morning, our study discussion was from James chapter 2. James chapter 2, as you know, deals with the faith and works concept. And again, in our study, we were refreshed with the idea of knowing that our faith is demonstrated by what we do. We don't just say, I have faith, and let that stand alone as though that's all God expects of us, but it has to be demonstrated in some action of some kind. And we don't, of course, as some people say, merit and earn our salvation because of any works in baptism. That's not the case, but we're simply following through on God's commands. And true it is today, we give back to His kingdom as one of God's commands to give to Him. And this is what we do out of love, and again, not to earn any salvation, but again, to show and demonstrate the love that we have for God. So when we give, we're putting our faith in action this morning, and I hope you'll do that as I do, as we sing about it beforehand, first stanza. And we'll sing this just a little bit slower than we might normally for the first stanza only.
I care not today what the morrow may bring, if shadow, sunshine, or rain. The Lord I know ruleth o'er everything, and all my worry is vain. Living by faith in Jesus above. Confiding in His great love.
you pray with me? Our Father in heaven, we're so grateful to take this time to reflect on all the things that you've given us. Father, as we've thought about the spiritual blessings, we now take our minds to the physical things that you've given us in this world. And Father, we couldn't even begin to count all the things that you have done for us even this day. But Father, we know that all good things come from you, and we pray, Father, now that we may think of those things, think how we're blessed, and give back a portion that the work here and around the world may be further. We pray all these things in your Son's name. Amen.
We'll sing number 23 after the lesson this morning, if you'd like to mark that. Now number 781, we'll do the first and the last stanzas. If you would, please stand, we'll sing it together.
Wonderful story of love, tell it to me again. Wonderful story of love, wait.
Good morning. And if you don't feel welcomed yet, we certainly hope that you do now. We're glad to have you with us this morning. As Brother Duke Manier said at the beginning of our service, we're thankful for your presence. We are glad that you're here. We're glad to have our members here. We're glad to have visitors with us. And we always have some who are with us who are from other places. And if you've come to visit with us this morning, we're glad that you're here. We want to meet you. Welcome you to our services at Maysville. I am very glad to be with you this morning, having been out of pocket for the last 2 weeks on Sunday. I am thrilled to be here. I appreciate very much Brother Seth and Ryan taking care of the preaching a couple of weeks ago. That was a planned time for me to be out. I was preaching a meeting in Henderson, Tennessee. Last week, I definitely was not planning to be out, but was flat on my back, literally, with an injury to my back, and I'm glad to be up and going, and I appreciate Ryan Smallwood and Hal Todd, who stepped in at the last minute last Sunday and took care of that, and Steve Bramlett, my class, and I appreciate these gentlemen very much in their work and stepping up. Kids growing up, I suppose, are the same now, generally, as they were when I was growing up. If you hang around them, there's a lot of sarcasm. They get pretty mouthy toward each other, sometimes toward adults. Most of what they say perhaps would be okay. Some of it might not be suitable to repeat in a place like this. But I can remember on more than one occasion someone getting hot under the collar from somebody being too bossy when I was growing up, and someone would quip out, "Well, who died and made you king?" And it was pretty clear what was the message there, that someone felt like someone else was exercising authority, and maybe authority where it didn't belong. That may not be an exact Bible quote, but you know, there's actually a passage of Scripture that's not too far off from that. It is a Bible topic. Join me, if you will, in Matthew chapter 21, and let's start reading at verse 23. Matthew chapter 21, 23rd verse. "Now when he came into the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people confronted him as he was teaching and said, 'By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?'" The question that the elders of the Jews, the chief priests, want to know from Jesus is, how is it that you think you should be able to do this? It may not be with the same kind of sarcastic phrases that the kids used, but they wanted to know, who died and made you king? How did you decide you should be able to do this? What does authority mean to you? In doing a little research, it is interesting how many different areas of business, of schools, of social groups are spending time talking about generational differences. And the perception that people have differs by age. If you talk to someone who's under 20 about what authority means to them, you're going to get a very different answer than if you talk to someone who is in their 70s. And maybe as we go age to age, bracket by bracket, we might find a significant difference among those groups. I found just this last week a very interesting, rather lengthy document from the United Nations, of all places, talking about the challenges of bringing certain concepts into the awareness of the public because of the differences in how generations perceive these things and authority and responsibility and function in a number of areas actually was on the list of what they wanted to talk about. It's clear that the chief priests, the elders of the people in Matthew 21, 23, understand the concept of authority. They wanted to know what gave Jesus the right to do the things that he did. They understood it. It's also clear that even our founding fathers were expressing the concept of recognizing authority. The second paragraph of the Declaration of Independence from the United States starts as follows. "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the government. Of the governed. That's authority. The Declaration of Independence had two concepts there. One, a recognition of delegated authority. We have been endowed by our Creator with unalienable rights, with unalienable power of authority. And secondly, that governments draw their power essentially from the governed. Now, that concept is not held by most governments around the world. But it's a part of the concept that framed our Constitution and would hold those thoughts. It's interesting that psychologists writing today talk about the empowering of youth. And they say that the concept of empowering our youth oftentimes leads to the misunderstanding that our youth are the ones who have authority. That's a challenge. And if you're not involved in any groups where you have connection to some of our children, you may not see just how closely that holds true. Our public school systems, and I suppose private school systems to some degree, have for some time dealt with the problem of authority in the classroom and authority at school. It used to be the case, generations before, that when a child got in trouble at school, the parents sided with the school. Today, if a child gets in trouble at school, it is often a parent who wants to sue the school for those actions. Where has the authority changed in that regard? Secondly, I would like to note that the concept of authority is around us nearly everywhere we look. Let me provide a couple of easy to understand concepts first. How did you get here this morning? My guess is that for the large majority of you, you drove here. How is it that you drove? My guess is you drove out here on one of our roadways. Did you notice the road that you were driving on? Probably not. Did you notice, for example, if it was properly marked, that there was a yellow stripe down the middle of the road? Did you notice that there were white stripes on the edge of the road? And then you might have a difference whether that road, that edge was either solid or dotted. Did you know that a solid line means that is a lane that you should not cross? And that a dotted line means that is something you can cross? And that a yellow line, and only a yellow line, on our roadways is used to differentiate between directions of traffic so that yellow is on your left and white is on your right when you are having directions of a traffic that's going in two directions. All roadways are like that in the United States. Those are laws or rules. And hopefully when you go to school or when you take a driving course, you understand and learn about some of those rules. At the end of our parking lot, as you go out onto Ryland Pike, you're going to find a stop sign there. Why is that stop sign there? It is there to direct traffic. It is a position of authority. And it doesn't matter what work you do. It doesn't matter what your economic status is. It doesn't matter what gender you are. You are subject to the authority of that sign. A little farther down, if you go into what we call the four-way, you're also going to find some flashing lights. Drive on into Huntsville, you're going to find more control devices all around us. And of course, there's always the ever-popular blue lights when we fail to remember the stripes and the signs and the speed limits and the other things. The signs of authority. I was going into the bank the other day and came up to the glass, and before we ever got into the building, it had a sign there, and the sign said, remove your sunglasses, remove your hats, turn off your cell phones, take off your hoods, and, you know, a person could, if they were looking at that, say, how do you have the authority to do that? Their answer, if you ask the bank president or management that question, they would say, well, we don't have the control to cause you to do anything out in the world. But if you want to come in and do business with us, if you want to put your money in the bank or you want to draw money out of the bank, if you're going to interact with our tellers, you're going to take off your sunglasses and take off your hats and hang up your cell phone. Or else we're not going to do business with you. We understand that concept of authority. If you're employed, I am certain that there are certain rules that your employers also maintain. They expect you to be at work at a certain time. They may expect you to dress in a certain way. They may expect you to behave while you're there at work and do certain functions while you're there. We are aware in life of the concept of authority. And what happens without it? What would happen without authority? Imagine for a moment what it would be like to drive on the roadway if there was no authority out there. If you could drive anywhere you wanted, on any side of the road, at any speed you wanted. When you came up to an intersection, you did whatever you wanted. You weren't going to stop there intentionally, are you? Nobody wants to stop and wait for a light. No one wants to stop and wait. Why don't we just all get out on the road and drive wherever we want, however we want? Before the end of the first day, there would be people up in arms demanding that we come up with some rules to regulate the operation of our motorways, because without authority we have chaos. Imagine your schools with no authority. If children came and did whatever they want, you're going, that's what they do now. Imagine life without authority, and we can find ourselves, how would you have a football game? There's probably no one in this auditorium who watched football yesterday. Imagine a football game with no authority. No referees, no rules. You just did whatever you want. Well, anyone who knows anything about football would quickly say, well, you can't have a football game without rules. You have to have certain goals. You have to have certain concepts that provide guidelines for what a team is, how many people you're going to have on the team, and where they're going to line up, and what they're going to do, and sometimes even how much pressure we're going to have in the football. What kind of world would we live in without authority? Which brings us to our next subject of consideration. What about authority in religion? It is certainly the case that we have abundant discussion of authority in the Scripture. And I'd like to look at several passages as we establish this idea. The first is in Acts chapter 17, and I'm going to start reading with the 24th verse. It is clear that God is the ultimate authority. We're going to pick up in the sermon that Paul delivered in Athens to those persons who were philosophers there at Mars Hill. Acts 17:24. God, who made the world and everything in it, since He is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands, nor is He worshipped with men's hands, as though He needed anything, since He gives to all life, breath, and all things. And He has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on the face of the earth. The rest of Paul's sermon you can read there, but that's adequate to understand what Paul grants to God is that God is the ultimate authority. Sometimes there are words in Scripture that need a little translation, even though they're translated properly into English. For example, the word Lord. We don't use the word Lord very regularly in our normal conversation. We use it only as it applies to religion. And as it applies to religion, sometimes we use this word without really understanding what it means. The concept of Lord is the naming of one who is in position of authority. In fact, it is the authority. And so if someone is Lord of something, they are the authority over it. And Paul says that God is Lord. He is the authority. He is in control of, in charge of heaven and earth. So Paul says God is the ultimate in what we would describe as authority. Second, we would note that God has delegated or given that authority to, first, primarily, His Son. The place of Jesus is unique. And as we look to Scripture, we find that His place is described as a unique one. And there is no one who has a place of authority greater than Jesus. I want to look at four passages to establish this. All of them you are familiar with. Beginning in Matthew chapter 17 with the first verse. We sometimes call Matthew 17 the Transfiguration. What we mean by that is that Jesus goes up on this mountain, and while He is there, His appearance is changed. He is transfigured. I'm not particularly this morning interested in the very unique thing that happens to Jesus, although that is of itself a great story. I'm interested in how Jesus was identified by God to these disciples. Matthew 17, 1. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by themselves, and He was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and His clothes became as white as the light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with Him. Then Peter answered and said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If You wish, let us make here three tabernacles, one for You, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. Now let's pause there for just a moment and establish what it is that Peter's suggesting. While Jesus is here with His disciples, there are two other, now deceased, but returning spirits. They are of Moses and Elijah. Often when the Old Testament scriptures are discussed or described, they are referred to as Moses and the prophets. Elijah would have been foremost among the Old Testament prophets. Moses certainly would have been what was considered the lawgiver. So as Jesus is there, from Peter's point of view, these were the two men that Scripture held in highest regard. We have Moses and we have Elijah. And Peter's actually making, from his point of view, a grand gesture to say Jesus should be included with these two men. He says, I recognize that Jesus is in the same category as Moses is. I recognize Jesus is in the same category of Elijah. For a Jew to have made that statement about Jesus would have shown a great deal of respect for Jesus. But it was disrespectful in reality. Because God saw that Moses, Elijah, and Jesus were not equal. Jesus was not coming up to the level of Moses and Elijah, but rather Jesus stood above Moses and Elijah. Listen to the response that happens after Peter makes his remarks. Verse 5, while he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and suddenly a voice out of the cloud saying, this is My beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear Him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. But Jesus came and touched them and said, "Arise and do not be afraid." When they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. Here they are on this mountain. Peter says, "We're going to put Jesus in a category of Moses and Elijah." And God says, "Don't listen to Moses and Elijah. Listen to my son." And when the cloud moves away, there's no one left but Jesus. Matthew chapter 17 provides an insight into the concept of authority that God had given from himself to Jesus, his son. Hear him. The second reference that I'd like to make to establishing the authority of Jesus is found in the book of Hebrews, chapter 1, and the first two verses. As the writer of Hebrews begins to look backward at history and talk about what has happened in the past, he says, "God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in time past to the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son." The writer of Hebrews establishes the same thing that Matthew chapter 17 does a few moments before. And that is, as God spoke in the past through, and it doesn't leave out Moses and the prophets here, spoke through the prophets, and Moses was a prophet, spoke through the prophets, but now he speaks to us through, God speaks through his Son, Jesus. So when we hear the words of Jesus, we are getting the authority of God, and God has put Jesus in that place of authority. And then the writer of Hebrews goes on to describe how Jesus has been put, whom he has appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory, the express image of his person, upholding all things by the word of his power. And we have discussed those many times. The third passage I would like for us to consider is in the Gospel of John, chapter 12. And these words come from Jesus himself. John chapter 12, start reading with me in verse 44. "Then Jesus cried out and said, 'He who believes in me believes not in me, but in him who sent me. And he who sees me sees him who sent me. I have come as a light into the world, that whoever believes in me should not abide in darkness. And if anyone hears my words and does not believe, I do not judge him, for I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world. He who rejects me and does not receive my words has that which judges him. The word that I have spoken will judge him in the last day. For I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me gave me a command what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his command is everlasting life. Therefore, whatever I speak, just as the Father has told me, so I speak.'" Jesus himself, in declaring his own authority, says, "When I talk, it's because God has told me what to say. And when you hear the words I say, you are listening to the words of God, and in conflict with that. If you deny the words I'm saying, you deny the words that come from God." I know that you're familiar with the last words that are recorded for us in the Gospel of Matthew, the words that we sometimes refer to as the Great Commission. And in that Great Commission, Matthew chapter 28, beginning in the 18th verse, Jesus claims, "All authority has been given unto me." Where? In heaven and on earth. Now, a few moments ago, when we began in Acts chapter 17, and Paul talked about God, and he called God Lord, that is to have the authority. Where did God say he had authority? Over everything in heaven, over everything on earth. In Matthew chapter 28, in the 18th verse, where did Jesus say he had authority? Over the things in heaven, over the things on earth. You see the connection there? God has given His authority to His Son Jesus. He said, listen to Jesus. And then Jesus claims, I have this power from God. The next two verses there in Matthew chapter 28 take us one step further. Having given the authority to Jesus, Jesus then delegates some of that authority to His disciples. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. There are many life applications that we can make from that. Jesus, in giving His responsibility to His disciples, and those disciples or apostles would go and preach throughout the world, and that would delegate authority to elders. Paul would delegate authority to Timothy, to Titus, to others who performed in certain functions. And perhaps we'll come back to those in other lessons. But I want to ask one more question and make one more thought before we conclude our discussion this morning. How do people respond to that authority of God and to that authority of Jesus? And some rebel. The concept of rebellion means that an individual refuses to follow authority. We may find ourselves talking about rebellious children. And there is certainly the case that there are children who rebel against their parents. I know that many of you, if we were to sit and talk privately, could describe situations where you knew of an unruly child, a child who refused to be submissive in school, a child who refused to be submissive to their parents. And the word that describes them is rebellious. There are persons who refuse to be subject to the laws of the land, the laws of government. And Paul will express in the book of Romans, as he described our responsibility in Romans chapter 13, that we have a responsibility to follow after the government. And if we had time, we would pursue that course, but we do not. But what happens when a person rebels against God? I'd like to look at Romans chapter 1 for a moment. In the 18th verse of Romans chapter 1, Paul begins to talk about those who refuse to listen to God. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. What does it mean to be ungodly and unrighteous? It means to refuse to follow the authority of God. And then Paul will go on and describe some of the traits of those who are here. Verse 21, they knew God, but they would not glorify Him as God, nor were they thankful. Verse 28, they did not want to retain God in their knowledge. You see, these persons that Paul is describing here, these are persons who know about God, but they don't want God. They know what God wants, but they don't want to do what God wants. And what does Paul say regarding them? They're in rebellion against God. And the last half of the 28th verse says, God gave them up to do those things which are not fitting. What does it mean to be in rebellion against God? Especially in Romans chapter 1, we find a number of discussions that take place, but one of them particularly is on the subject of human sexuality. And Paul will specifically bring up the subject of men who are involved with men and women who are involved with women and say this is against the law of God. It wasn't too long ago that many of us in the United States sat and watched with some dismay, but certainly not shock, when the Supreme Court ruled that persons of the same sex could marry in the United States of America. To whom did they appeal for their authority? They did not appeal to all of human history for that authority, because all of human history shows the relationship of marriage between men and women. They certainly did not appeal to God for that authority, because God clearly said that marriage between human beings should be between men and women. They appealed instead to themselves and said, this is what we want, this is what we're going to do. And humanity then themselves said, this is the authority that we will appeal to. God said he is in authority and that he has given that authority to his Son. Men sometimes rebel against God, but not if they're doing like Jesus did. I have one more reading that I would like for us to consider this morning. It's from Philippians chapter 2. In Philippians chapter 2, as Paul was describing the relationship that we ought to have not only with other people, but also with God, Paul said, let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men, and being found in appearance as a man. Now notice what comes next. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has also highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name. And I want to watch very carefully as we read the next two verses. What has God done to Jesus because he submitted to the will of God and because he was obedient to God? God gave him a name that is above every other. Now watch. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Jesus Christ is Lord. You know what those words mean? That means that a person is willing to say, Jesus Christ is my authority, that they stand over me, that he is the one who controls my will and my way. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus would then ask, in Luke chapter 6, verse 46, how can you call me Lord and not do the things that I say? The process of conversion that we describe with one another is the change from rebellion to submission. It is the person who believes that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that that Christ is Lord, and that we make a confession of that. In Romans chapter 10, verse 10, with the mouth confession is made, with the heart one believeth unto righteousness. What we believe in our heart changes us from within. Do we make a confession with our mouth? You're familiar with Acts chapter 2, verse 38, and where Peter said, repent and let every one of you be baptized for the remission of sins. Repentance means we change our lives. And baptism, the ultimate submission to the authority of God. There is only one authority, and it is God. All other authorities derive their power from God. Our constitutional framers believe that. The Apostle Paul believed that. Jesus, God's Son, believed that. The apostles who wrote the Scriptures to us believed that. The question is, what do we this morning believe? That every knee should bow and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Is that the view that you hold this morning, that Jesus Christ is Lord. It may be that you have come to that belief and need to respond in obedience this morning. It may be that you have not been baptized for the remission of your sins and would choose to do that today. Everything stands in readiness. If you would confess before this audience your faith, you could be this morning baptized into Christ. It may be that you are a child of God, but you're not living with that confession that you believe Jesus is the Lord of your life and that Jesus is the authority that you should obey, and you need to come home. The invitation of Christ is for you and extended this morning. If we can assist you, we invite you to come as we stand and sing.
Thank you, Tim. Appreciate you being here this morning. If you're visiting, we'd like for you to come back any future time. Let us know if we can serve you some way. Next Sunday, I want to go ahead and announce ahead that we'll have a guest speaker here at this hour. And please try to be here and attend. One of our Caribbean missionaries will be coming in for a stateside tour. And we're fortunate to have him for one of our services on Sunday morning. Worship hour, Brother Albert Isaacs will be with us. And some of us got to hear him speak. We were down in Nevis, and he's fairly dynamic preacher there. So you'll be interested in being here and listening to his message next Sunday morning. Number 17 will be our closing hymn. Number 17, we'll do the first and the last stanzas, and then be dismissed with our prayer.
Old people that on earth do dwell, sing to the Lord with cheerful voice. Him serve with fear, His praise foretell. Come ye before Him and rejoice. For why the Lord
last bow. Father, as we come to you in prayer, we ask that you protect us as we leave. We ask that you give us courage to be a light to the world. We ask that we respect the authority given to your Son by obeying his word, by sharing this word with others. Father, we pray that those that have been mentioned that are sick, that you will be with them, that you will give them strength, that you will give them recovery. Father, we pray for those that are also traveling, that you will bring them back to us safely. In Christ's name we pray, amen.